22 laps to go of this Shanghai International Circuit. It's shaped in the shape of the Chinese letter Shang, which means high or above. And you were certainly high and above the track here in the commentary box. There's a huge grandstand that you can see in the background there. And Tony Elias, well, he looks pretty relaxed, doesn't he, for a rookie, 22 years of age. His best qualifying position so far in MotoGP, 8th place, 3rd row of the grid. Wonderful stuff from Elias in qualifying in the dry. And he could have looked much more relaxed than that in the conditions as they are today. It's going to be hard and it's going to be long. And it's going to take the likes of this man, Kenny Roberts, 9th fastest, 3rd row of the grid for the 31-year-old, another wet weather specialist. And experience is going to count for a lot in this race today. It's going to be a tough ride for the likes of Tony Elias. So the grid clears then. As I said, we're in a bit of a rush here today because of the lateness of the 125 and 250 races. But the MotoGP race is starting on time. And the front row of the grid for it, Sete Gibernau, Marco Melandri and Loris Capirossi. John Hopkins, Nicky Hayden and Valentino Rossi, the world champion on row two. Row three, Carlos Checa, Tony Elias, what a performance from him. Kenny Roberts in 9th place. Row four, Shinya Nakano, Alex Barros, who's second in the championship after that win in Estoril 2 weeks ago, and Troy Bayliss, Colin Edwards, Max Biaggi and Olivier Jacques, who rides for Kawasaki here in place of Alex Hoffman. Ruben Schaus, Robbie Rolfo, Toru Okawa riding as a wildcard for Moriwaki on row six. And then on row seven, it's Jürgen van der Gerberg, who's riding in place of the injured Makoto Tamada here in the Konica Minolta Honda team. And then the two WCM machines at the back of the grid, Franco Battaini and James Ellison. Watch out for those two riders, incidentally. Both of them picked by the WCM team boss, Peter Clifford, because of their ability to ride in the wet, because they know that that's really their only chance of standing out in the race and getting in amongst the rest of these boys. And there is James Ellison, as you can see, on that number 77 machine, getting in and amongst the riders on the warm-up lap. He was 10th fastest in the actual Grand Prix warm-up this morning, a 20-minute session. Ellison, the former World Endurance Champion and the former British Superbike rider in his first full season of MotoGP this year. Watch out for him later in the race.
Yep. Rain is pouring down again now in pit lane. Obviously, it's too late. Very interesting, as we saw last week. All the bikes are lined up in pit lane, ready for them to come in, but they won't be coming in. This is a wet race. It's going to stay wet throughout the race, so no problems with bikes or people having to come in and change tyres. That white flag will not be going out. This is going to be a wet race. It's going to be a very interesting 22-lap encounter here at Shanghai.
Well, it is the first ever MotoGP race here in Shanghai. We've got a good crowd that have turned out here despite the weather conditions. It's been like this since first thing this morning, absolutely pouring down. As you said, Nick, it's still raining now. Perhaps not. We've had worse than this actually today. It was like a tropical storm, wasn't it, this morning, that led to the postponement of the 125cc race. But still very difficult conditions out there.
It certainly is. I'm just looking at the helicopter hovering overhead, doing the overhead camera stuff, and it keeps disappearing into the cloud and into the mist. It is very difficult conditions. Just spoke to Casey Stoner and the other 250cc riders, and they were saying those last five laps of the 250cc race were very, very difficult indeed. But they're going to race. They're going to ride. It's the first ever Grand Prix in China. And I've got to say, despite the weather conditions, despite their love of Formula One, there is a decent crowd here this afternoon. We had a great 250cc race won by Casey Stoner. A fabulous 125cc race run by Matteo Fazzini. Will it be close with the big boys as the MotoGP boys make their way back to the start and finish in front of me here in pit lane?
We ride with Valentino Rossi. As I said, it's not been a smooth ride for Rossi so far in qualifying this weekend. He's had some front end problems with that Yamaha, which he has had all season. The chassis has been made a little bit narrower, a little bit more rigid to try and help with acceleration and top speed, but they've countered that with some problems in the flexibility and handling of it, and we know that that is crucial in wet conditions, and these Hondas are going to take some beating today. They're led by Sete Gibernau, the man on pole position, his teammate right next to him, Marco Melandri, and then the Ducati of Loris Capirossi on the outside of the front row.
Yeah, grid forming up in front of me. The red flag is still being shown. And God, the rain is absolutely bucketing down now, I've got to say. It's as heavy as we've seen it. Perhaps not in the quite as heavy as it was this morning, just after the warm-up, but it's very, very heavy indeed. Well, Sede Gimenao is known as a man who can ride in the red. Marco Melandri, Loris Caparossi on that front row. How will Valentino Rossi do from the second row of the grid? History is made. MotoGP is in China.
Great start from Sede Gimenao from the front row. John Hopkins getting a flyer as well from the second row of the grid. It's Hopkins up on the inside of Melandri. Hopkins laying on the brakes, and it's Hopkins who leads the way. Sede Gimenao runs it wide into turn one. Marco Melandri through to second place, but John Hopkins leads the MotoGP event for the first time in his career.
Oh, what a start by John Hopkins. Well, he's starting from the second row of the grid. He's absolutely flying on the Suzuki. Now, let's see what John Hopkins can do. He tells us he can do it. Suzuki think he can do it. Now it's down to John Hopkins himself.
They come down through this sweeping section. A bit of a wobble there for John Hopkins. It's going to be very interesting to see how he copes with this back straight. Kenny Roberts has made a flying start there as well, his Suzuki teammate. And Roberts going around the outside of the two Hondas there. Marco Melandri and Sete Gimenao. And up to second place. And if I'm not wrong, the two Suzukis now lead the way. They do.
You're
it's Hopkins
wrong.
From Roberts.
You're not wrong. Two Suzukis lead the way on the Bridgestone tyres. The rain pours down. They're being chased by the two Telefonica movie star Hondas, but I think Valentino Rossi is getting up the inside of somebody. It's very, very difficult to tell in those conditions.
Yeah, Rossi threw on Melandri there and starting to put some pressure on Sete Gimenao as well. Tony Elias, I think, is up there in sixth place. He is, so the Yamaha's coping well with the conditions so far, but the Suzuki's absolutely flying. This is the first chance for the Hondas to pull them back. Here comes Kenny Roberts up on the inside of John Hopkins as they come into the left-hander. Not quite close enough to make a move. Rossi on the inside of Sete Gimenao. Rossi now up to third place. Gimenao drops to fourth. They flick it left and right through that chicane. Oh, Hopkins just running a little bit wide there and letting his teammate Kenny Roberts take over at the front. They come down this long back straight now. Hopkins struggling to keep the throttle on through the corner, and Rossi up to second place.
Kenny Roberts leads the way on the back straight, 330, 340 kilometres an hour. Through the spray they go. You see Nicky Hayden there, we saw Troy Bayliss. But Kenny Roberts, the former world champion, leads the way from the current world champion, Valentino Rossi. Rossi on the brakes, thinks about going up the inside of Roberts, decides perhaps I better not, but he almost goes through, and Roberts almost invites Rossi in. Rossi doesn't accept the invitation and says, no, let's just leave it a little bit longer. But the conditions out there for these machines are very, very dangerous indeed.
Tony Elias is absolutely flying in third place. The MotoGP rookie on the Yamaha is up behind the world champion, Valentino Rossi. It's Roberts who leads the way. The first lap of the Chinese Grand Prix here at Shanghai. Roberts from Rossi, from Elias, from Hopkins. Here comes Max Biaggi on the inside of Marco Melandri. Sete Gimenao, so Biaggi there up to fifth place, and Hopkins there just struggling with Biaggi as well at the end of the straight. So, oh, Gimenao losing a couple of positions there.
Well, Max Biaggi has had an awful weekend so far. His 200th Grand Prix. Perhaps the rain is his saviour. He has a little bit of a wobble, and Gimenao almost gets back alongside him both on Hondas, but just stays in front, Biaggi. Just look at those conditions. We ride with Sete Gimenao. That's Max Biaggi in front of him. As I say, his 200th Grand Prix appearance. He really has had an appalling time so far. But at the front, Kenny Roberts, the 2000, that's 5 years ago, 500cc world champion.
Oh, Max Biaggi on the inside of John Hopkins. He almost touched. Hopkins is shoved wide by Max Biaggi, but just manages to keep his speed and bring it back round. And Gimenao starts to give Max Biaggi something to think about as well. Gimenao passed Biaggi once again.
Yeah, I think that was a mistake by Max Biaggi. Sete Gimenao saw the advantage and got his way through. This is pretty hairy stuff on these machines in these conditions. But the man at the front, as I said, 2000, he won the 500cc World Championship for Suzuki. He leads away from Valentino Rossi. Tony Elias, what a ride by him in third place. Up into fourth place comes Sete Gimenao. John Hopkins, the early leader, relegated to fifth. And at the moment, Max Biaggi in sixth place. And Marco Melandri, seven.
There is Sete Gimenao. We know he's a wet weather rider. And a slight wobble there again from Sete Gimenao. That's the corner that we saw Andrea Dovizioso have a big wobble in the 250s. We'll talk more about that in a little while. Look at the top speed of those Hondas on the Suzuki down that back straight. Suzuki there giving away around 20 kilometres an hour in top speed. But look at the way Hopkins makes it up on the brakes. Rossi also closing in on Kenny Roberts. This Suzuki looking very, very good in these tight and twisty sections.
Oh, one of the Hondas running wide there. I don't know if it was Biaggi that ran it wide. It's very difficult to see in the sprite.
I think it was Nicky Hayden, actually, there, Nicky. Was being shoved wide a little bit by the Ducati of Loris Capirossi, but he's managed to bring it back round. Olivier Jacques, actually, there as well, riding the Kawasaki. Jacques replacing Alex Hoffman this weekend, the injured Alex Hoffman. Jacques is back in MotoGP, and he's doing very well indeed. Jacques currently in ninth place.
Yeah, so it's Rossi second, Elias third, Shimano four, Biaggi five, Hopkins six, Melandri seven, Hayden eight, Jacques nine, Capirossi 10, Barros 11, Van der Gerberg 12, Bayliss 13, Edwards 14, and Rubens Chaus in 15th place. And Carlos Checker, a very disappointing 16th at the moment.
Kenny Roberts has seen that he's got a chance here to go for it. Roberts is leading the way. I said on the grid that it could be the experience of a man like Roberts, a wet weather specialist, 31 years of age. He's been there, done it, won a world championship. That 2000 season, all sorts of conditions, remember, Nick, wasn't there in that season when Roberts won the championship? He is a man for all seasons, and he's back at the front of MotoGP.
Kenny Roberts has always said he can reproduce that sort of form if he's given the right machinery.
The man, man on the move here, Nick, sorry to interrupt you there, Jürgen van der Gerberg, the second fastest in the warm-up this morning. Ooh. In the wet. Van der Gerberg riding the Konica Minolta Honda in place of the injured Makoto Tomada. And there's a retirement there, Shinya Nakano pulling in after just two laps.
Yeah, Shinya Nakano in. I'll make my way down pit lane, just try to find out what the problem was with Shinya Nakano. But that's disappointment because, again, you probably would have fancied the chances of the Kawasaki team in these conditions. But Shinya Nakano out. But Kenny Roberts just showing you what can be done if you get it right in these conditions. Valentino Rossi, we've hardly spoken about him. He hasn't looked too bad in second place, though, has he?
No, and this is what it's all about in these conditions, isn't it, as well? Gibbonau is actually making some progress in fourth place, putting some pressure on Tony Elias. This is a battle behind them between John Hopkins and Olivier Jacques for sixth. And as you can see there, it's Kenny Roberts and Valentino Rossi leading the way. Tony Elias there on the Yamaha in third place. Still behind him is his compatriot, also a Barcelona resident, just like Tony Elias. Sete Gibbonau in fourth, and look at this behind him. It's all going on. John Hopkins, Marco Melandri, Olivier Jacques, and Jürgen van der Gerberg having a good old battle down at the end of the straight there and into the tight hairpin. That was excellent from John Hopkins to hold off the Hondas. We saw the advantage that they've got down that back straight, but Hopkins leaving it very, very late indeed. The times here at the moment, 2:17 from Kenny Roberts, the fastest lap of the race so far from anybody out there, and Roberts extending his lead at the front over Valentino Rossi. Olivier Jacques there coming under pressure from Jürgen van der Gerberg. Van der Gerberg on that V5 Honda, stepping out of a World Supersport team. He was riding for Ducati in the World Supersport Series until last week in Valencia. Look at John Hopkins there around the outside of Marco Melandri, once again demonstrating the ability of that Suzuki in those tight and twisty corners. And nobody demonstrating that more than his teammate Kenny Roberts, who continues to lead Valentino Rossi at the front. A long time since we said that, isn't it? Roberts leading Rossi at the front of a MotoGP race, but that's what's happening here. Roberts' last win coming in the wet at Motegi at the end of that championship-winning 2000 season. Oh, and there's a jump start there for Alex Barros. So Alex Barros, who's currently lapping in 10th place, we're on board here with the Brazilian. He's going to have to come in for a jump start. He's going to get the sign from his pit board. It's going to be difficult to see in the spray here, but Barros is going to have to come in for a jump start.
Yeah, that is cruel luck for Alex Barros. Of course, 2 weeks ago, won that Estoril Grand Prix. That's going to ruin any chance he had. We're still waiting to speak to Shinya Nakano. They did think when he came in there was a mechanical problem. Perhaps he could change bikes. But of course, because the tyres, it was all too much of a problem. So he didn't do so. He's still explaining to Harold Eckhold and the team exactly what went wrong. But as soon as we can get a word with him, we will. But disappointment here in the Kawasaki garage. But Olivier Jacques doing a good job in his battle with Jürgen van der Gerberg. It's a battle of the two men brought into MotoGP. And there'll be a lot of pride at stake in that battle, won't there?
Oh, certainly will. Olivier Jacques, I think, feels that he has something to prove after being dropped by Yamaha. Now, Max Biaggi's on the move, and in fact, both Biaggi and Gibbonau have got past Tony Elias there for third place. So Gibbonau now to third place, Max Biaggi fourth, Tony Elias fifth, then the slight gap. And here on the brakes, it's, I thought Olivier Jacques was just going to have a look up the inside of John Hopkins there, but he doesn't.
I just had the butt in. Tony Elias has also been accredited with a jump start. Tony Elias, the pit tell me, and Erta tell me, also a jump start, and they're preparing for him to come in. That is real bad luck for the Spaniard.
Oh, that's dreadful for Tony Elias. What a race he'd had as well, lapping in third place for such a long time. And we will find out now. Penalty drive-through is the sign that Barros is going to be shown on the next lap, not on this lap. But drive trough, as in fact, as they say on the Camel Honda pit. But
yeah, that's a pretty good description, actually, isn't it?
Yeah. Meanwhile, at the front, Valentino Rossi is closing in on the race leader, Kenny Roberts, rather looming there, that number 46. A bit of a wobble there, actually, for Rossi through that fast right-hander. And you just wonder now how long Roberts can hang on. Well, not for long. He's run it wide, and Rossi takes advantage. The championship leader, the world champion, leads in the Chinese Grand Prix. There's confirmation of that jump start for Tony Elias. But more importantly for the outcome of this race is this. Kenny Roberts there coming into this right-handed. Valentino Rossi is a long way away from him, but it's a mistake from Roberts, who runs it wide. And Valentino Rossi gets his chance, and he doesn't need too many of those.
He's looked in tremendous control and really great form in these conditions.
Kenny Roberts has gone. It looks as though Kenny Roberts has got some sort of mechanical problem. Oh, and there's another man down. That's Alex Barros. So he's not going to come through. Oh, in fact, it's Troy Bayliss. Troy Bayliss, Barros' teammate, has crashed out. And that's dreadful disappointment for Camel Honda. Now then, there's Kenny Roberts in the middle of your screen, being passed by the rest of the field. And Kenny Roberts, who looked on course to return to his glory days at the back, at the top of the MotoGP podium, is retiring from the Grand Prix of China.
Yeah, I mean, the Suzuki pit at the moment, and they just cannot believe it. They do not know what the problem is. Obviously, I'm actually in the pit. They're looking at the screen, and Kenny Roberts led the Grand Prix, but obviously now is a major problem for Kenny Roberts, and I can tell you there's some pretty desperate faces in here at the moment.
Well, that just came, Nick, after he'd set the fastest lap of the race, a 2:16.591 from Roberts on the previous lap. He was extending his lead over Valentino Rossi at the front, and now he's been forced to return to the pits. Tony Elias there still lapping well in what is now fourth place, behind Givinau second, Biaggi third, Elias fourth. But Elias, remember, is going to have to come in for a drive-through. It'll be interesting to see now. There is the big yellow 24, and Tony Elias almost sits up out of his seat in surprise there to see that. But it is a jump start for Elias. Now, the fastest man on the circuit now is John Hopkins. We have a look at Max Biaggi, just having a look at the inside there. Oh, and we've got Carlos Checa running across there. Carlos Checa has crashed. Carlos Checa is out of the race. He's going to try and get back into this, but it looks as though it's all over for Carlos Checa. He dejectedly lifts his Ducati to his wheels. Here we're going to see it again. It's coming into the left-hander, into the start-finish straight, and look how far he slides as well down the service road. It was a long jog back to his Ducati for Carlos Checa, but Checa is out.
It's all happening out there, isn't it? And in the meantime, Valentino Rossi just rides that steady line through these conditions and is riding a very great race at the front. There's really mixed emotions here in the Suzuki camp, as you can imagine, because John Hopkins is fighting back. Kenny Roberts, I think, is going to be due any moment now. The mechanics are out. They're trying to signal something in through the spray. Here he comes, Kenny Roberts, the early race leader on the Suzuki with the Bridgestone tyres, comes back into the pit. Kenny Roberts' race, as you so rightly said, is over. The former 500cc world champion, though, showed us just a glimpse of what he can do.
It's all over. Oh, it's almost all over for Olivier Jacques there, up and out of his seat of the Kawasaki. Just manages to hang on. An excellent save there by Olivier Jacques. I was going to say it's all over for Kenny Roberts. It's not all over yet for Team Suzuki. Their second rider, John Hopkins, is still out there, and he's the fastest man on the circuit at the moment. A 2:16.3 from Hopkins on the last lap, and he's now looking for a way past Tony Elias. There is that moment for Olivier Jacques. A bit of a tank slapper there for Jacques. A reminder of the old 500 days, of course, when he used to ride for Yamaha in this class.
Can I just put in, Matthew, just going to have a quick word with Paul Denning, the Suzuki team manager. Kenny, you've just had a very quick word with him, Paul. What was the problem?
An engine problem, probably caused by water getting in somewhere. It just started to cut out and stopped, and obviously was smashed. So,
thanks for your time.
Paul Denning, their team manager for Team Suzuki. Tony Elias just letting John Hopkins and Olivier Jacques past him, but back on the gas. Elias back in front of Jacques, but it's John Hopkins there. Paul Denning's other rider, who's out there and on the move at the moment. Here comes Jacques on the inside. Now Elias is going in for his drive-through penalty for that jump start. Here comes Tony Elias down into pit lane, lifts his visor up. Little shake of the head there. I'm sure he's absolutely gutted about this. Now he won't have to stop. He just has to keep the speed limit and drive through pit lane. So he's looking for the setting there to keep the speed limit there on his Yamaha and make sure he doesn't. Now, there you go. They're telling him to just make sure he didn't break any speed limits. That's what Ruben Schaus did. You may remember his teammate in Estoril 2 weeks ago. Schaus breaking the speed limit and getting another drive-through after that. So now then, Valentino Rossi has stepped up the pace. Maybe he's aware of the charge of John Hopkins from the pack behind him. Here comes Tony Elias back out onto the track after that drive-through. But the fastest man at the circuit at the moment is Valentino Rossi, the race leader. He has a lead of 5.8 seconds over the man in second place, who looks actually like Max Biaggi. It was Seto Gimenao when they passed, when they crossed the line the last time, but just in the background. Oh, and there's Hopkins. Hopkins is off in the gravel. He's back on the track, but Hopkins has charged. Here we see it. And if I'm not mistaken, that was a raid. That was a corner where Roberts ran into engine problems. Hopkins runs off into the gravel, but he's able to turn it round and get back on.
Yeah, he's back on the track. I'm actually in the Kawasaki pit at the moment, but Shinya Decano with all the team members are still looking at the telemetry to say exactly what went wrong. We still wait to see. It really is difficult to see out there at the moment if Max Biaggi has got in front of Seto Gimenao.
No, he hasn't.
There we go.
Yeah, Gimenao comfortably in second place. It was just a glimpse of Max Biaggi as we saw Rossi go through, and it wasn't quite clear if Gimenao was still in between the two riders, but he is. Gimenao in second place, Max Biaggi third, Olivier Jacques now in fourth after that runoff for John Hopkins, Vanden Gerberg in fifth, Barros in sixth, Marco Melandri seventh. Barros, of course, who still has to come in for his ride through penalty for a jump start.
Well, sorry to butt in, Matthew, but I'm with a very disappointed Shinya Nakano. What was the problem?
Problem was engine, I think electric. So engine was running okay, but I couldn't feel power, you know. I was riding like one cylinder missing, you know. So that's why I between, and now they are checking what was the problem.
And how difficult were the conditions out there, Shinya? We've seen so many of his riders crash and go off.
Yeah, because problem is I couldn't see front, you know. When behind some rider, I couldn't see because of water. But sure disappointed, you know. But still we have many races, so it's okay.
Shinya, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Shinya Nakano there, out of the race with a mechanical problem. It seems as though Kenny Roberts may have had a similar problem with his Suzuki Water, getting into the electrics there. But Nakano's teammate, his former teammate, of course, from the 250 days, and now back with him at Kawasaki in place of Alex Hoffman, Olivier Jacques up to fourth place now on the Kawasaki, and Jürgen van der Gerberg in fifth. Two riders who came in this weekend, couldn't believe it when they got the phone call last week to say, boys, we need you out in China, we've got two injured riders. First of all, Jacques, who actually tested the Kawasaki at Estoril the day after the race in Portugal 2 weeks ago, and then had a brief test in Japan as well before coming down to China. He's now fourth, and van der Gerberg, who literally got a text message from Luca Montiron, the team manager for Konica Minolta Honda, as if to say, are you free next weekend? We've got a bit of a job for you in China.
Yeah, you've got to take these opportunities when they come. One, they got the opportunity, and two, the conditions have helped them even more, and they've taken them with both hands. Congratulations to them both, with so many riders sliding off. And it was interesting to hear what Shinya Nakano said. He just couldn't see what was in front of him, and it really is very, very dodgy out there, as many of the riders have shown us. But Rossi, you got to say, absolutely supreme. You've got to admire the man. I arrived in China with him. He came to China on Thursday morning. He only just got the plane, actually, from Frankfurt on Wednesday night. Who knows what would have happened if he'd have missed that plane? He probably wouldn't have arrived here on Friday morning. He's flying out tonight. He gets on the bike and he just rides a quite brilliant race at the front in these conditions. You really have got to admire him. He's here for the minimum amount of time. Doesn't matter. He can still put up with the conditions and he can still ride quite brilliantly at the front.
Yeah, you can see the tracks that have been left on the circuit, firstly by Rossi and then the men behind him. There is so much standing water out there that the riders leave a trail behind them. It looks as though the conditions are more suited to an outboard motor and a jet ski than a motorcycle, but these riders, all of them out there, every single one of them, riding very, very bravely indeed. Here's Alex Barros now coming in for his ride-through penalty, as Tony Elias did just a couple of laps ago.
Yeah, poor old Alex Barros. Has been the best of weekends for him. He crashed and hurt himself on Saturday morning. Didn't qualify where he wanted to on Saturday afternoon. Of course, he won the race in Estoril 2 weeks ago. It's very, very important for him and those World Championship aspirations for him to try and score as many points as possible. But a 10-second penalty, a drive-through penalty, is all you need, isn't it, when you're facing these sort of conditions. But the master of the conditions, the master of MotoGP, and the master of China at the moment is the man we all know about. It's Valentino Rossi. He is absolutely supreme in these conditions. And here comes Alex Barros, just gone past me. He's got ride-through penalty. Be interesting to see at the end of the next lap how far that pushes him down the field. Quite a way, one would imagine. But Rossi on rails.
Yeah, Barros coming back onto the track in 12th place, actually, there, Nick. Rossi leading the way, as you said, Nick, but the fastest man on the circuit at the moment is actually the man in 4th place, the man we were just talking about in here as a replacement for Alex Hoffman, Olivier Jacques on the Kawasaki. A 2:16.013 from Jack in 4th place. He's 8.3 seconds down on the leader, Valentino Rossi, and what? Around 7/10 of a second quicker on that lap. Here he is, coming past Max Biaggi. Oh. Jack now up to 3rd place and within a sniff of the podium.
That is absolutely amazing. We spoke to Olivier Jacques on Thursday afternoon. He said he hadn't been on a motorcycle for 7 months. And that it was quite a big surprise when he went to the test in Estoril just to get his brain around the speed and everything else. He is riding an inspired race in the conditions. He hasn't ridden a motorcycle for 7 months. He's gone past Max Biaggi. Biaggi fights back. But Olivier Jacques and Jürgen van der Gerberg in 5th place. This is sensational stuff as Rossi gets him back. But Jacques really has got the bit between the teeth. But Biaggi wants to finish on the podium for the second Grand Prix in succession.
Well, it's a long time since we've seen a Jacques attack, isn't it? How we've missed it. Here it comes on the inside of Biaggi once again. Biaggi with a superior top speed on the Honda. Jacques using the handling capabilities very, very well indeed of the Kawasaki. And, of course, those Bridgestone tyres. The fastest lap of the race so far, once again from Olivier Jacques. Biaggi again trying to take advantage of that Honda horsepower. But Jacques holds him off at the end of the straight and holds on to 3rd place. Can he chase Jibber now in 2nd?
Really, we cannot speak too highly of Olivier Jacques. This is a quite incredible performance of a man who hasn't raced really competitively, what, for 2 or 3 years, at least 2 years. He's had those wild card entries for Morawaki. He's fitted in when people have wanted him. This was really fitting him when Alex Hoffman wasn't able to ride and the Kawasaki brought him in for this race. And of course, the French Grand Prix in Le Mans in 2 weeks' time. But he is riding the race of a lifetime. He may have won that 2000 World Championship for the 250cc class. But this performance is amazing. And Irv Kanemoto and the Honda hierarchy just cannot believe it that Max Biaggi is really struggling now to get 3rd. And it's Olivier Jacques in 3rd place and really scorching, setting the pace here in the rain on the Kawasaki, of course, with those Bridgestone tyres. The man he's got in his sights now, Sete Gibernau in 2nd place. But the man at the front, seemingly on rails, is Valentino Rossi.
Yeah, Olivier Jacques just took 3/10 out of Sete Gibernau in 2nd place. As you can see, Rossi is around 5 or so, just actually over 6 seconds ahead of Gibernau in 2nd place. By no means out of Jacques' reach with 12 and a half laps to go. And you just saw the Honda hierarchy, as you said, Nick, looking on there. I'm sure they want Max Biaggi to recover points and ground here. But you've got to say, from a purist racing fan's point of view, and I'm sure everybody at home is rooting for Olivier Jacques here. What a story out of the Grand Prix wilderness. He's been racing touring cars in the French Championship, would you believe, driving a Renault.
Well, that's what's done it. He knows all about it. He thinks he's got 4 wheels out there, doesn't he?
Perhaps that's why
he's riding. He is closing on Gibernau. And this is an extraordinary performance. Number 19, the former 250cc world champion, back in MotoGP. And he's chasing 2nd place. And who knows if he gets into 2nd place, what happens after that. And the other man that's having a great ride, Jürgen van der Gerberg, the Dutchman, replacing the injured Makoto Tamada. He's currently running in 5th place.
Yeah, I mean, almost overshadowed, isn't he, by the performance of Olivier Jacques, who's again set the fastest lap of the race. He's just taken 1.1 seconds out of Valentino Rossi at the front. At this rate, Jacques will catch Rossi at the front. And that performance, as I said, almost overshadowing this from Jürgen van der Gerberg. What a ride from the Flying Dutchman in 5th place. He's ahead of Marco Melandri, Nicky Hayden, two of the factory Honda riders behind him. He's never ridden that V5 Honda before this weekend, not ridden a Grand Prix bike since 2002, and never ridden a four-stroke Grand Prix motorcycle before, and here he is in these conditions in 5th place.
What an amazing race this is. Hey, we're all getting wet. If we're not Italian, everybody's cheering from Olivier Jacques. There is Olivier Jacques in 3rd place. The man in front of him is Sete Gibernau. He's still setting those fastest laps, as Matthew said, at 2:15.155. Biaggi's still in 4th place. Van der Gerberg 5th. Melandri 6th. Hayden 7th. Hopkins 8th. He led the race early on. 9 is Colin Edwards. 10 is Loris Caparossi. Ruben Chaus in 11th place. James Ellison having a great ride in 12th. 13th is Tony Elias, despite that ride through penalty. 14th is Franco Battaglini. And in 15th place, Turo Akawa riding the Morawaki Honda. But all eyes now on number 19. It's the Frenchman, Olivier Jacques, as he chases second place from the man that's finished runner-up in the championship for the last 2 years. That is Sete Gibernau.
You know, Nick, I actually saw Olivier Jacques ride this car. He has ridden this Kawasaki before, not just in the test in the last couple of weeks, but he was at Valencia last November writing for a French magazine. And you know, at the end of the season, the journalists get to come and test all the bikes. And Jacques actually came as a test rider for a French magazine to ride the Kawasaki and write a report about what it was like to ride a MotoGP bike. And would you believe it, what, 6 months on, here he is in with a shout, not just of a Grand Prix podium here in China, but even of catching Valentino Rossi and winning this race.
Yeah, I think he's got to work very hard to get past Sete Gibernau. Gibernau riding a very steady race now in second place. But can he catch the man at the front? We wait to see. But he has that fastest lap, a 2:15.155. Rossi has crossed the line in front of me. We wait for Gibernau. Gibernau now. How close is Jacques? He's pretty close. 0.6 seconds between them. And 11 laps to go as they break for the right-hander at the end of the start and finish straight.
Jacques just running it a little bit wide there, Nick, but he's got to break so late. Let me tell you that in the third section of that last lap, which includes that 1 mile straight, Gibernau took around 0.6 seconds out of Jacques just in that straight. But in the tight hairpin and the left-hander between that, Jacques took 0.8 seconds back off him in that section. That's the difference between the two backs. A wobble there for Gibernau, and again it's Jacques through this twisty section round that roller coaster first couple of corners. He's caught right back up with Sete Gibernau, and he's got him in his sights.
He certainly has got him in his sights as they race through this left and right downhill section. Fast section in the wet, in the dry, extremely fast if you're out there in the wet. There's Valentino Rossi. This is the battle for second place. And as Matthew says, Jacques closes through the twisty bits, but when they get on that back straight, the Honda is very, very quick indeed, and he opens up the advantage again. So he's got to rely on the brakes, Olivier Jacques, at the end of the back straight and try and get back at him. But he certainly is now within closing distance. There's Rossi leading. He brakes and goes into the left, and these are the two men battling it out for second place still. Sete Gibernau, second in the race in Jerez 3 weeks ago, crashed out in Estoril 2 weeks ago when he was leading the race. And Olivier Jacques, back out of the MotoGP wilderness, not only chasing a podium position, perhaps a second place, and who knows, if he gets that Kawasaki into second, what will happen after there. And they are the confirmation of the tyres. I don't think that took a great deal of working out. Gibernau and Jacques, rain mediums, front and rear. The difference is Gibernau is on the Michelins and Olivier Jacques on the Bridgestones.
The other difference is that Sete Gibernau's on a Honda and Olivier Jacques on a Kawasaki, and there, that's what I was talking about on the last lap, down the back straight. You just saw, it was like the old accordion effect, wasn't it? Gibernau pulling away from Jacques down the straight, but Jacques having to do everything he can on the brake to try and make up the difference and closing back in on Gibernau. And I would not bet against Jacques making one of those famous attacks on Gibernau at the end of the straight here and through that winding section. We'll have a look at it now. They come side by side almost down with 10 laps to go. The fastest lap of the race so far has been set by Olivier Jacques. It's a second quicker than the man who leads the way, Valentino Rossi. Once again, we see how Jacques just runs it a little bit wide to carry the corner speed through this long right-hander, and then it's a twisty left. That's where Rossi's going now, through that twisting left. And here come Gibernau and Jacques behind them. Jacques is as close as he can be to Sete Gibernau. There's a chance for him to overtake Gibernau here as they come through this long left, and then there's a right-hand kink and then a right-hand hairpin. And if Jacques can get close to him through this kink, he could have a chance. He's not close enough. They go down onto the brakes again. First gear for this right-hander. And Jacques really could not be closer, could he? Now then, there's another flowing section here where Jacques could try and make a pass on Gibernau. First it goes left, then it goes right. We'll see him run it up the outside of Gibernau here to get the inside into the right-hander. Again, he's not quite close enough.
No, not quite close enough. But he's certainly, I think, closer when they get onto the backstroke than he has been for some time. It would just be interesting to see when they do get there how close he is, because, as you say, when he opens up the throttle of the Honda, Sete Gibernau, it's very, very difficult for Jacques, and he is not close enough at the moment. And Valentino Rossi, I'm sure, very happy with the situation. How interesting it would be just to see, though, if he did get past Sete Gibernau, if he could start attacking Rossi at the front. But he's not getting past Gibernau. Gibernau still holds that advantage. Jacques still in third place. They're going to come onto that backstroke any moment now. onto it they come. And you've got to say that Jacques probably is not going to be close enough on the Kawasaki to actually try and outbrake him at the end of this very, very fast straight. Chimenez running a very good race in second place, but nobody at the moment can hold a candle to the man at the front, Valentino Rossi.
5.7 seconds now, the gap between Rossi and Giovinazzi. He's opened that up by 0.4 in the last section. Will he have opened it up any further by now? We look to see he has. He's taking another 0.2 out at the front. So Rossi extending his lead. But as I said before, Jack very strong in the second part of this race circuit. And again, he closes up on the rear of Seto Giovinazzi.
Yeah, I think really he's going to probably have a go at him at the end of the start and finish straight, don't you? He's as close as he has been. They come through this twisty bit that brings him into that.
Yeah, it's just trying to stay close to him there, though, isn't it, Nick? Because the Honda, as we said, does have so much horsepower, usable horsepower coming down the straight here. Rossi with the fastest lap of the race so far, a 2:14.7 from Rossi, almost 2 seconds quicker than his previous lap. You just maybe wonder if he got the hurry-up signs there from his board, but Rossi stepping up the pace with a comfortable lead at the front and opening up his advantage once again to 6.4 seconds.
He just plays with your emotions, doesn't he, Valentino Rossi? You want to make a really good race of it, and you say, well, Giovinau, and certainly if Jack can get past him, there may be a chance, and he just does that to you, doesn't he? It just shows why he's the greatest motorcycle racer, certainly at this present time, perhaps of all time.
Yeah, it certainly is. It's a wonderful performance from Rossi, no doubt about it. He's had setup problems here in the dry all weekend. Didn't really run too well in the wet either, the Yamaha, but they've obviously worked very, very hard in the warm-up this morning, and who better than Jeremy Burgess and the rest of his crew to come up with something in a short space of time before this race. And once again we see Rossi pulling it out of the hat. He qualified over a second off pole position yesterday for the first time since Donington Park in 2001, when he was 11th on the grid, and he went on to win that race at Donington Park on the 500cc Honda, and he's going to do that again, it looks, today. Again, proof of Rossi's determination and ability, as I said, to pull things out of the hat. You just wonder now, Nick, 9 laps to go of a 22-lap race. This is the 14th of them. And Olivier Jacques, as we said, he's not ridden a race motorcycle for over a year. You just wonder now, physically, it's a tough circuit at the best of times, but particularly in these conditions, physically, it must be starting to take its toll.
Yeah, I think probably it is, and the likes of you and me would settle for third place, wouldn't we, and say, what a great comeback, we're on the podium. But I think Olivier Jacques still got a little bit more left, but I think just that top speed of the Honda just means that he just can't get that advantage on the brakes and actually get past Seto Giovinazzi. Won't say he's holding him up, I think that's very unfair to Seto Giovinazzi, but he just hasn't got the power where it really matters to get past him. And Giovinazzi, I think, won't be too disappointed to finish in second place. Obviously, he doesn't want Rossi to win the race because that would open up an even bigger points advantage, but to pick up 20 points in these sort of conditions, it's a marathon, it's not a sprint, 17 rounds of the championship this year. But any doubts we had about Valentino Rossi, early season testing. Oh, I think some people, even us, might have questioned his motivation this season. There's no problems about his motivation out there in these conditions. He is riding quite brilliantly, and he holds a 6.639 second advantage over Seto Giovinazzi in that battle with Giovinazzi and Olivier Jacques.
Fastest man on the circuit now is the man in sixth place, Marco Melandri. We haven't spoken for a long time about the guys behind, have we? Max Biaggi in fourth place at the moment. And then Jürgen van der Gerberg still in fifth. Marco Melandri sixth, as I said, the fastest man so far. A 2:14.717 for Melandri. He's got Jürgen van der Gerberg well in his sights now. And that could be an interesting battle there for fifth place. Here they are, in fact. Here's Jürgen van der Gerberg in fifth on that number 16 Konica Minolta Honda, vacated, of course, by Makoto Tomada with injury. And Melandri running it very, very wide there as he looked to get a run on van der Gerberg into the hairpin. And just a bit too wide. But you would imagine that that's not the last Jürgen van der Gerberg will have seen of Marco Melandri by the end of this race.
I think you've got that absolutely right. He really was on the charge on the brakes.
Oh, Colin Edwards.
I think, is that a blown engine? I would imagine it is. Colin Edwards, I would imagine, is out of the race. That's how he didn't drop in any oil. Davide Previo, the team manager of Yamaha, Gulwai Yamaha, looks on. He's got one man leading the way, but he looks like he's got one engine rebuild. And Olivier Jacques has got past Seto Giovinazzi. Olivier Jacques is now up into second place. What a ride by the Frenchman. Now, can he cut back any of the advantage of Valentino Rossi up the front? But he's got past him, and just look at the advantage he's already opening up over Seto Giovinazzi.
Once again, Giovinazzi will close up on the back straight, but as you said, Nick, the advantage he's already got of Giovinazzi should see Jacques clear now in second place with 7.5 laps to go. Has he got enough to catch the man at the front? There it is. Valentino Rossi and Olivier Jacques has Rossi in his sights. He's left Gibbonau for dead in third place. Olivier Jacques on the charge. As I said, now this is a big, big test for the Frenchman. How hard has he been training while he's been unemployed? Let's have a look. Olivier Jacques, 8 laps to go. Well, 7 laps to go now as they come round. Once again, Rossi crosses the line. What's the gap? Olivier Jacques on the charge. He's got Sete Gibbonau out of his way. What can he do? 6.128 seconds, the gap between Rossi and Jacques. But that is Jacques' fastest lap of the race, 2.14.719. I make that around 0.003 of a second slower than Marco Melandri's fastest lap of the race. And that is 0.007 of a second quicker than Rossi in front of him. There's only 7 laps to go. Jacques' going to have to step it up by another 3 or 4 tenths every lap if he's going to catch Rossi. But it's certainly not beyond the realms of possibility.
Yeah, just looking at Rossi's pit board. I'm in the pit at the moment. It says 6 laps to go, 6 point, and they haven't put the actual advantage. OJ, and they've had to actually sort of put in a different OJ because they've come in a little bit of surprise that OJ is up there. All the other riders' names are neatly printed out in yellow, but OJ has had to be hastily painted onto the board because I don't think they expected Olivier Jacques to be out there. But let's see what the board tells him. There is quite a lot of tension here in the pit, but Valentino Rossi, you would say, at the moment has got things comfortably in his pocket.
Let's have a look now. It was 6.181 seconds. It's now 6.2. So as you quite rightly say, Nick, Valentino Rossi opening up an advantage in the first half of that lap, but it's not over yet because, as I said before, Jacques is quick in the second half of this lap, and there is still time for him to close that advantage. Let's watch Jacques now. It's particularly through here, this left, and then the sweeping right that he's very, very quick in, and Gibbonau found that out to his cost, didn't he, on the last lap. Gibbonau now on his own in third place. The gap between Gibbonau and Biaggi now stands at 6.9 seconds. Then it's a further 1.1 back to Marco Melandri, who's got past Jürgen van der Gerberg in the battle for fifth place. Van der Gerberg now sixth, then 3.3 seconds to Nicky Hayden in seventh, John Hopkins in eighth, Colin Edwards in ninth. An interesting battle between the three Americans there in the fight for seventh place. Ruben Schaus 10th, Loris Capirossi in 11th place. And as I said to you there, look, Olivier Jacques making up time in the second part of the section, but actually Sete Gibbonau there as well, recovering a couple of tenths. Loris Capirossi 11th, and James Ellison, Nick, currently in 12th place. Peter Clifford's WCM team. And Ellison in
flying, isn't he? He's doing a great job. The board for Valentino Rossi told him there was 6 laps to go, and the gap between them, the hastily scored on OJ, is 6.4 seconds. That's what they're telling Valentino Rossi. As well, I say, they had to find a quick OJ. I think it may have changed.
Yeah, because I'm telling you, Nick, now it was 6.4 seconds when they came through the third split. What they don't know and what Rossi doesn't know is that Jacques pulled back another 0.6 of a second in that final section, so the gap is actually only 5.8 between Jacques and Rossi.
Well, I thought I'd better get down to the Kawasaki pit, got to be fair, and I can tell you there is great excitement here, down here, and they're just Harold Eccles, the team manager's having a very, very close look at things. But you're right, we can see 5.8 seconds now, as he did pull back about 0.6 of a second.
Here comes Marco Melandri on the inside of Max Biaggi on the brakes into the right-hander. Marco Melandri going through for fourth place ahead of Max Biaggi. So it's now Melandri in fourth, Biaggi in fifth, Van der Gerberg sixth, and then John Hopkins has just got past Nicky Hayden in that very interesting battle for seventh.
Marco Melandri coming a bit late in the race, but really getting his skates on now. Max Biaggi, after such a disappointing weekend, well, sure he'd have wanted to finish on the podium, but he should pick up some World Championship points, and who knows, Jürgen van der Gerberg really has got a golden opportunity to get after these two. You just got a glimpse of them at the back of those two. This could be a very, very good race to the finish. As I say, I'm in the Kawasaki pit. We're just going to wait and see exactly what they're going to tell Olivier Jacques. They have got a number 19 board, so they're a little bit better prepared than a Valentino Rossi's Yamaha board that had to scrawl on an OJ because they didn't have one. But we just wait to see what they're going to tell Olivier Jacques. Number 19 on his board, Kawasaki. Let's wait and see what happens. But I've got to say, the Alex Hoffman stickers are still on the board as well. Alex Hoffman, of course, out of the race with that broken scaphoid, replaced by Olivier Jacques, and he is performing beyond anybody's expectations.
The gap now between Rossi and Jacques is 5.4 seconds, with that final section still to come. Can Olivier Jacques repeat his performance in those couple of sections on this lap. If he does, he'll take 0.4 back, and he will just be 5 seconds behind with five laps to go. It's a 2:15.6 from Rossi. It's a 2:14.8 from Olivier Jacques. He's closed down by another 0.8 of a second. Jacques is within 5 seconds of Rossi with five laps to go.
Oh, great excitement here. They're just saying, 3 seconds and an arrow at the moment on Olivier Jacques Ford, and he's in second place. They've now altered it to four laps to go. But as you so rightly say, he is closing on Rossi. I think it's perhaps time now to go back out, well, in the rain anyway, and just see what they're telling Valentino Rossi when he comes through next time.
John Hopkins is actually the fastest man on the circuit now. Fastest lap of the race so far for John Hopkins. Remember, he ran off the track, but he's just posted a 2:14.6 in seventh place to close to within 2.4 seconds of Jürgen van der Gerberg in sixth. We stick with Olivier Jacques. We keep our eye very closely indeed on these timing screens. The gap between Rossi and Jacques is 5.2 seconds. Rossi just opening up a slight advantage, as he has done on the past couple of laps in the first sections, maybe even in the second section as well. You may expect to see Rossi at least hold on to that 5.2 lead. It's down to 5 seconds. Jacques gets stronger as the lap goes on. Remember, Jacques is on the attack. It's just over a tenth of a second he's taken out of Rossi in that second section. Can Jacques close down even more?
Oh, great, I wouldn't say great excitement, but great concentration here in the Gulwa Yamaha pit wall of Valentino Rossi. And as you so rightly say, we've got the screen right in front of us. It's just down to 5 seconds now, 4.5 laps to go. One would imagine Rossi can up the pace if he's got to. We wait to see. It really does make me smile, the board with OJ written on, scrawled on, after all the preparation at the beginning of the season, all those lovely printed out yellow letters, Barros, Chibinau, we can see them all there. But OJ's had to be written on at the last minute. And I think he's caught everybody at the last minute. It's an incredible ride by the Frenchman.
Rossi quicker in that section then, as he just ekes out a couple of hundredths of a second back from Olivier Jacques down the back straight. The Yamaha, as we said, certainly, well, Rossi and Edwards complain about the top speed of the Yamaha comparing it to the Hondas, but it's certainly got an advantage over this Kawasaki. But it's here where Olivier Jacques really makes up ground.
Yeah, they're going to tell him 5 seconds as he goes through, because of course that is the last part. But it's 4.3.
It's 0.7 of a second, I think. Olivier Jacques, he's just going to miss out here by about a lap. He's closing in on Valentino Rossi by about 7 or 8 tenths with every lap. But the gap at 4.3 with four laps to go, my maths, even my limited maths, tell me that it's not going to be enough. Rossi, I think, is just going to hold on here unless Jacques can really pull something out of the bag or Rossi makes a mistake. Sete Giovinazzi currently on his own in third place.
I think Harold Eccles adding up with his fingers as well at Kawasaki pit, and I think they probably just about come to the same conclusion. If you'd have told Kawasaki that they were going to have a second place in the Chinese Grand Prix, they'd stop the race now, I can tell you. They wouldn't worry about him trying to win the race. There's some very smug and very nervous smiles here at the moment. Harold Eccles, with his hands behind his back, just looks at the screen and concentrates. But nobody could have expected this. I would say this is the ride of the season so far by Olivier Jacques. Number 19 on the Kawasaki. He is having, well, almost the ride of a lifetime, isn't he?
Well, it is the ride of a lifetime, Nick. And you look back and you would have said to Olivier Jacques yesterday, what was the ride of your lifetime? He'd have told you Australia 2000, winning the 250cc World Championship from Shinya Nakano. And I bet that he believed that that would be the greatest racing moment of his life. He would have never thought he would be back in MotoGP. He would have never thought he would be fighting for a Grand Prix podium. He's never scored a Grand Prix podium in MotoGP. His best finish was fourth at Le Mans on the Yamaha in 2003. And here he is in second place. A slight wobble there in that long right-hander that brings him back onto the long back straight. But Olivier Jacques here has returned, and his Grand Prix career will be remembered now, not for that ride against Shinya Nakano in Australia in 2000, but for this.
Yeah, they're getting the board ready. They're telling him 6 seconds, and you just get the feeling with the race coming to a close that they're going to be very happy with this situation, and they don't want him to push it too hard, chasing Valentino Rossi. They take second place, and what a second place it would be.
Yeah, those 6 seconds, of course, the gap between Jacques to the man in third place, Sete Giovinau. Yeah, so they're telling him, look, second place is virtually done. We've got a rider walking across the gravel there in the background. I think it might be Ruben Schaus. But Jacques has just set the fastest lap of the race so far, Nick. He's taken 1 seconds out of Valentino Rossi. A 2:14.3 for Olivier Jacques. Three laps to go. 3.2 seconds the gap. If he can keep repeating this for the last three laps, he's going to win this race.
Oh, forget your fingers. Harold Eckwood now is rubbing his brow. Thinking, who knows? He's got his hands in his pockets now, and who can blame him? It's an incredible situation here. And, well, I think this next lap is going to tell us an awful lot, isn't it? Oh. Can Valentino Rossi step it up? And he really is skating through the puddles at the moment, isn't he?
That's 1/10 already in the first section in favour of Jacques. It's almost like a tennis match, isn't it? It's like juice, and it's now advantage
15 all, 30-15 to Jacques.
Here comes Jacques once again into the second section. This is where Rossi has had the advantage on previous laps. Don't be too worried, Jacques fans, or Gibernau fans, or Biaggi fans, if Rossi ekes back a bit of an advantage here through this section, because Jacques is so strong in the second two. The gap was 3.1. It's now, well, just still 3.1, but just less. Jacques is still closing. It's bit by bit. He's taking bites out of Valentino Rossi's lead. It's two nibbles in the first two sections. Will it be two big mouthfuls in the final two?
Oh, they just cannot believe it here, I can tell you. And as you say, it's that first two sections where he's very quick indeed. Now, let's see if Jacques can pull something back on him. But they really cannot believe it. It's an incredible ride by Olivier Jacques. 2.5 to go. We wait for the next split time.
Further back, Marco Melandri currently on his own in fourth place, 2 seconds ahead of Max Biaggi in fifth. Van den Gerberg still in sixth, but Hopkins closing down. There's that wobble once again through that long right-hander for Olivier Jacques. So many riders having problems in there, and it's that's cost him there in that second section, 0.09 of a second. And in fact, now he's really going to have to pull something out in this final section to continue that sort of rapid rhythm of taking chunks out of Valentino Rossi's lead. I don't think he's going to do it on this lap, and it could be this lap that ends Jacques' chances of winning this race.
Yeah, I think that one moment could be the difference between trying to win and trying to settle for second place. It was a slide in the wet, it was a wobble. That might have just been the warning for him to say, come on, let's settle down, of course I want to win.
Yeah,
second place would be incredible.
He has set the fastest lap of the race so far, a 2:14.133. for Olivier Jacques. His only problem, the fact that Valentino Rossi stepped up and did a 2:14.225. Now, we just saw Sete Gibernau shaking his head, Nick, as he crossed the line.
Absolutely.
He's just done a 2:17.9, Sete Gibernau. Just lost 2.5 seconds off his lap time all of a sudden. And it looks as though Gibernau's having trouble.
Certainly does. That was a big shake of the head. I mean, obviously no indication in the pits what is going on. Sete Gibernau could be having problems, and it would be an absolute disaster for him if he lost that on that third place. Little bit of a wobble there from Valentino Rossi. Through the mist, through the spray, you can see Olivier Jacques. The gap was just over 3 seconds, and you just think with a lap and a half to go that Rossi has just done enough. But what a performance by Jacques. But let's keep an eye on the Gibernau situation, who's currently in third place.
Yeah, and he's just lost even more time, Nick. Now I'm looking, he's 10 seconds down on Olivier Jacques, and 11 seconds in fact, and 3.4 ahead of his teammate Marco Melandri. We'll keep an eye on that split time now. And there's Harold Eckeluk, the team manager for Kawasaki. He said, okay, second place is enough. We've got 1.5 laps to go. And let me tell you, Nick, Gibernau is in serious trouble in third place. He's just lost another 2 seconds there on Jacques in third place. And his teammate Marco Melandri now is just 2 seconds behind him. And I think Marco Melandri is going to catch Sete Gibernau here.
That's cruel luck for Sete Gibernau, dropping right back. Marco Melandri will have to go past him, wouldn't he? Can't protect anything because Max Biaggi and Jürgen van der Gerberg are close to him. But Olivier Jacques, well, seemingly now on his way to second place, coming in as a wild, well, to replace the injured Alex Hoffman. Hadn't ridden a motorcycle for 7 months, as you say, been driving touring cars in France, doing rides for journalists. He said that he saw, I think it was Max Biaggi or one of the Repsol Honda riders at the airport in Kuala Lumpur. He was on his way to Australia to help with a riding school on road bikes. They were going for MotoGP testing, and he said it was Alex Barros, actually. He was so jealous that he wasn't going to be riding in MotoGP. He is riding in MotoGP. He's just got 1 lap to go to finish in a quite incredible second place.
He's just backed off the gas as well, Nick. He closed in on Rossi by half a second on the first 3 sections of that last lap. He would have closed in more in the final section, as he has done on every previous lap, but he knows now that he's not going to catch Rossi. And even if he did catch him, he'd have to try and pass him as well on this last lap. Jacques is settling for second place. We take a look at the gap once more. It's going to be more than 2.5 seconds, I can tell you. 2.5, it's now 2.6. Jacques is settling for second place, but what's going on behind them? It's a close one now between Gibernau and Melandri for third. Half a lap to go. Melandri, I'm sure, is going to pass Gibernau here, because Gibernau's having problems.
Yeah, I tried to listen to the engine note as they went through the start and finish. It was very difficult to hear, but Giovinazzi is having problems. But perhaps not quite the major problems that he thought, though. I don't know. Melandri runs it a little bit wide there, but it just appears that he's just preparing to overtake, doesn't it? Sete Giovinazzi, who does seem to be having problems and a few wobbles as well.
Marco Melandri just looking for a way around his teammate now. Jacques just closing in there by, what, 6 tenths of a second, but not just Jacques rolling off the throttle at this stage of the race, it's Rossi as well. The two men, the two top positions, it seems, have been decided here. The final position on the podium has not. It's Giovinazzi and Melandri fighting out for it, and Giovinazzi doing everything he can here to close the doors on Marco Melandri, but there's no doubt that he's got a mechanical problem, and I can only imagine that once they get to a straight line, it's going to be Marco Melandri to make the pass. Here they come. Here they come down the straight. Well, perhaps, or on the brakes, here comes Melandri up on the inside of Giovinazzi, and easy as you like, Melandri smooth through to third place, and nothing at all that Giovinazzi can do about it.
Yeah, thank you, mate, teammate. That's very kind of you to be saying, weren't you? Yeah, but no, you're absolutely right, and you've got to say that Marco Melandri did exactly the right job. There they are, Valentino Rossi and Olivier Jacques. Jacques perhaps a little bit closer. That doesn't matter, does it? What a magnificent ride. And no, they haven't started the celebrations already here on the pit wall with the Kawasaki team. But I can tell you, they're getting ready for some mighty big celebrations. And so they should. That is an amazing performance by Olivier Jacques as Valentino Rossi crosses the line in front of me to win the Chinese Grand Prix.
Olivier Jacques takes a simply stunning second place on his return to MotoGP in replace of the injured rider Alex Hoffman at Kawasaki. Marco Melandri will complete the podium for Honda in third place. Three manufacturers on the podium, a Yamaha from a Kawasaki and a Honda, and Sete Giovinazzi limped home in fourth place ahead of Max Biaggi. What a performance as well from Jürgen van der Gerberg to complete the top six.
Try and get a word with Harald Eckel. There's a lot of celebrations here. The team manager for Kawasaki. That was an incredible ride by Olivier Jacques.
Incredible, yeah. This is the right word. I'm so happy. Fantastic result. First time on the bike. Of course, weather condition was good for Olivier. He likes the rain. But anyway, I'm very happy for Kawasaki, Bridgestone tire, especially for Olivier.
I think you'd have settled for second place when you arrived here on the aeroplane.
Never, never. This morning I was joking with Olivier and the riders. I brought a big suitcase in the office and I said, this is to bring the trophies back. And they were saying, maybe it's a little bit too early, yeah? But now it happened, so I'm very, very happy for this.
Harald, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Wow, an incredible firework display going off just behind you there in pit lane as well, Nick. The Chinese celebrating this dramatic first race in China. We'll be coming back here until at least 2011, and if every race is exciting as that one, we certainly won't be complaining. Valentino Rossi just checking that number 46 is still in place on the front of his bike, winning the first ever Grand Prix of China, and just dusting off the rain from his Yamaha. And really, Nick, we enjoyed incredibly the performance of Olivier Jacques in second place, but at the end of the season, when we look back at the championship standings, the really important result from today is not Olivier Jacques in second place, it's Valentino Rossi in first and Sete Giovinazzi in fourth.
And I'm standing alongside a man that would probably agree with everything you just said there. Olivier Jacques was perhaps the performance everybody's going to mention, but Valentino Rossi rode a quite brilliant race at the front. And with Jerry Burgess, of course, the two crew chief for Valentino, that was some ride, wasn't it?
Very good, you know, look, it was excellent. We felt pretty good in the rain, the bike's been getting better towards the end of last year, and it's good to get a race in the rain under our belt. Excellent job from Valentino to conserve the tyre and really control the race from the front.
He does make me smile, Jerry. He arrives here on Thursday, almost misses the aeroplane, just in time for practice, for qualifying. Going home tonight, 3 days in China, returns home, 25 points, thank you very much, wait for the next race. It is extraordinary, isn't it?
It's great. I mean, as long as we've got him on Sunday, we've always got a chance.
Jerry, congratulations. Look forward to seeing you in the mall.
Thanks, Nick.
There you go. Jeremy Burgess, it's official. Valentino, you don't even have to turn up for qualifying anymore. Just Sunday will do. And you just wonder if it really would make any difference where Valentino Rossi was on the grid. He was sixth today, but it didn't matter to him. He's gone through and taken a clear victory here. That was the moment that Marco Melandri passed Giovinazzi for third place. It will be interesting to find out from Giovinazzi's crew exactly what the problem was there. It might take them a while to find out because he's left his bike about, 500 metres away, right down at the end of of the straight here, the front straight, as he crossed the line. He's just parked his bike up and walked back. But here is his teammate. It's another solid performance from Marco Melandri. He finished on the podium in the first round at Jerez. He finished fourth in Estoril 2 weeks ago. Third here today means he is now second in the championship behind Valentino Rossi.
Trying to get a word here with Luca Montaron, of course, from the Konica Minolta Honda team, as we wait for Jürgen van der Gerber to arrive back. That was some performance by the Dutchman, wasn't it?
A very good result. Jürgen stay close to another Honda. It's the first time that he tested the MotoGP machine. It's a fantastic day. I think we have a good success today.
I think it must have been a good team manager picking a substitute for Makoto Tomada. Very clever substitution.
No, always the package is important. We have good team, good machine, and good sponsor. This is important.
Luca, go and celebrate with your rider. Thank you.
Thank you very much to you. Bye.
Luca Montiron there, the team manager for Konica Minolta Honda. Their rider today, Jürgen van der Gerberg, in place of Makoto Tomada, taking a wonderful sixth place. And there was Olivier Jacques celebrating with those Kawasaki mechanics. Who could have thought it? And there is Harold Eckel as well, the team manager there with Olivier Jacques. We heard from him as well. Olivier Jacques' first ever MotoGP podium, coming 18 months since his last appearance in the class for Yamaha at Valencia.
Well, we spoke to Luca Montaron. The man's just got off the bike and he's already speaking to us. Jürgen van der Gerberg, that was a dream. I know the weather wasn't, but what a performance.
Yeah, you know, the first time, basically this morning in a full wet, it felt really comfortable, the bike, you know. The Honda Konica Minolta is such a fantastic bike to drive, you know, together with the Michelin tires. A great performance. And I maybe could have risked a little bit more, but, you know, I didn't want to go down. This is just a weekend, I have to learn a bit. And don't bring the bike back in two pieces. I'm really, really happy with sixth position, you know.
Welcome back to MotoGP. I think you realise what you've been missing, and perhaps we realise what we've been missing.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Jürgen, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, let's hope we see Jürgen van der Gerberg again before the end of the season. I think he's proved a lot of people wrong here this weekend for letting him slip out of MotoGP in the first place. And then he's had a tough time with his team in World Supersport as well. But Jürgen van der Gerberg there, very, very good sixth place, place indeed. The doctor with his rubber gloves on, of course. No doctor goes to surgery without them. Certainly not Valentino Rossi. He went to surgery on the Shanghai International Circuit today. And a big celebration from the one world champion to another there. Rossi congratulates Olivier Jacques. Well, we all wish Makoto Tomada well, of course, for a swift return from injury. We hope to see him back at Le Mans. But if he doesn't make it, it would be great to see Jürgen van der Gerberg get that ride as well. He's accepted termination of his contract with his team in Ducati in the World Supersport. He's not been paid to ride here this weekend, and he's brought that bike home in sixth place. An excellent performance from him. And what can you say about this? Olivier Jacques, really, that is one of, for me, already, we're only three rounds into the season, but that is one of the moments I will remember when we sit at Valencia at the end of season party in November.
You're looking forward to that party already, aren't you?
Well, it was a good one last year, wasn't it, Nick? I imagine Olivier Jacques, if he's not still with us then as a rider, he'll be there, won't he, to celebrate?
I think we should have an honorary invitation, don't you, to the party. But you can see there's some very happy people here. Obviously, there's the three riders in the Parc Fermé. Olivier Jacques, one would imagine, is the happiest of them all. But good to hear Jürgen van der Gerberg, Luca Montaron, Harold Eckhold, absolutely, well, I think quite overwhelmed, actually, by finishing in second place. And it just gives a bit of heart to MotoGP when you see those sort of performances. And congratulations to them all. Also a good ride by John Hopkins into seventh place. Of course, he was leading the race, had a few typical John Hopkins moments, but he did well to come back into seventh place. And further down the field, Nicky Hayden, Ruben Chaus, Alex Barros, Loris Caparossi, James Ellison, the lad from Cumbria on the WCM. They said he was good in the wet. He finished 13th. Tony Elias, who had that ride-through penalty, in 14th place. But, yeah, all the headlines, I think you summed it up perfectly. Will it be Olivier Jacques finishing in second place? But quietly, well, he never does anything quietly, but very confidently, 3.5 days in China, on the plane home tonight, 25 more points. Thank you very much indeed. Good night, the doctor.
And those 25 points are the difference between Valentino Rossi and the rest of the field here. He leads the championship, would you believe it, from Marco Melandri. 70 points for Rossi, Melandri on 45, Barros 43, Biaggi 36, and Sete Gimenao struggling in fifth place on 33 points. And Olivier Jacques with that second place. He's now seventh in the championship, ahead of Shinya Nakano, would you believe it?
That's the cruel life of a MotoGP rider, isn't it? Shinya Nakano's had a cracking season. obviously not his fault that he had the problems, the mechanical problems very early in the race. We heard from him, did appear that he got some water in the works, didn't it, on the Olivier Jacques 1 ride. But well, I don't think anybody would have said, in fact, let's be honest, we were talking about this morning about the riders that had come in, both Jürgen van der Gerberg and Olivier Jacques. We didn't really give them any chance at all, even in these conditions, did we? They proved us totally wrong, and they proved us what good riders they are. But Olivier Jacques, I really got to say, that is a sensational performance by him. And who knows, if he'd got past Sete Gibernau a little bit earlier, he might have challenged Valentino Rossi. But you always get the feeling with Valentino Rossi, he's going to just up it that little bit more. This was a great ride by Rossi. He can ride in the wet, he can ride in the dry, he can battle at the front with 10 riders, he can ride a race on his own. It doesn't matter. He is the king of MotoGP. At the moment, he has shown China just why he is the best man on two wheels.
This is the ride that everybody's talking about. Olivier Jacques storming through the field. It was such an eventful race here. Riders going off, engines exploding, going into the gravel. Carlos Checa crashing, Kenny Roberts breaking down, Shinya Nakano breaking down. Then this charge from Olivier Jacques through the field. Then the pursuit of the man at the front. The crash there for Franco Battaini, the WCM rider. But this then was the last few laps of the race. Jacques hunting down Valentino Rossi at the front, and Harold Eccles saying, please, just slow down. Gibernau was comfortable in third place. A mechanical problem, though, no doubt for him. He was caught by his teammate, Marco Melandri. I suppose if anybody had to pass him, he would have chosen Melandri. It was Melandri who went through to take third place. It was a very, very important win in the championship overall for Valentino Rossi. A simply incredible second place for Olivier Jacques. And then, of course, Marco Melandri completing the podium for the second time from the opening three races of the season. But the winner, at the end of the day, that is the one that counts. It's another Grand Prix win for Valentino Rossi and Yamaha. His winning time, 50 minutes, 2.463 seconds. Well, we await the arrival of the three men on top. Olivier Jacques, of course, hasn't stood on the podium since he won the championship in Australia in the final round of the 2000 season.
And what a weekend we've had in China, haven't we? An absolutely cracking 125cc race. Casey Stoner winning the 250cc race. A display of world championship proportions from Valentino Rossi, but a ride by the Frenchman Olivier Jacques that had everybody on their feet. MotoGP has arrived in China. We haven't had very good weather. Everything else about the racing has been absolutely fantastic.
We await the arrival then of the top three riders here in China to the podium. Fabrizio Cecchini, chief mechanic there of Marco Melandri, shaking hands with Valentino Rossi, and Davide Brivio giving Olivier Jacques a well-deserved pat on the back. It was Yamaha who let Jacques go from MotoGP 2 years ago. In fact, Davide Brivio didn't have anything to do with that decision. Brivio just coming in just at the end of that. And I think Jacques has proved everybody here that he has the ability. They say that the rain is a great leveler in road racing, and that riders come onto a more equal level. It's regardless of their machinery and more about their talent. And I don't think that there can be any doubt that Valentino Rossi is the most talented rider out there. He's shown that with race victory. But Jacques has shown that he has the ability and the talent to match any of these riders out there. Perhaps not Rossi, but certainly the rest. That the scenery here at Shanghai, and you can see there the team buildings at the back there of the paddock, all those team buildings mounted on stilts. It's a stunning facility here. It's cost $250 million to build. It was built in 18 months, just in time for the Formula One race here 6 months ago. 200,000 spectator capacity, and really impressive statistics. 40,000 concrete pillars holding this place up in what is actually marshland here near to the Yangtze River. And 12,000 tons of steel. Herman Teich and Peter Wall, the architects who designed this circuit. It's a dream come true for China to have MotoGP racing at such a fantastic facility. And it's a dream come true as well for Kawasaki, as they now get ready to welcome their rider for the day and for the next round as well in Le Mans, the former 250cc world champion, Olivier Jacques. Three former 250 world champions will stand together on the podium. There they are. They get a first glimpse of their trophies. Rossi, Jacques and Melandri. Proof positive that the way to the top of MotoGP is through the minor classes 125 and 250. Here he is, Marco Melandri, now second in the championship, 25 points adrift of the leader. No clues for guessing who that is. Olivier Jacques stands on the podium for the first time in MotoGP and the first time on any podium apart from the French Driving Championship, Touring Car Championship, since 2000 in the 250 class. Valentino Rossi gives him a well-deserved shake of the hand and pat on the back as well. But it's Rossi who stands on the top step. Davide Brivio is up there as well to take the team's trophy for Gowaz Yamaha, who continue to lead the team's championship, incidentally. A very good day indeed for them. Yang Xiaodu, the vice mayor of Shanghai, will present the third place trophy to Marco Melandri. Wonderful start to the season for him, a mature ride. He got stronger as the race went on, Marco Melandri. Real proof there that it takes confidence as well as skill to ride in wet conditions. He didn't get the best of starts, but as I said, came on strong. He was closing down on the front two towards the end as well, Melandri, but not quite close enough. So Yu Zaiqing, the vice minister for the state of the general administration of sport in China, gives second place to Olivier Jacques. A wonderful podium for Kawasaki, an unbelievable podium for Olivier Jacques, the crowning moment of his career. At 31 years of age, he returns to MotoGP and makes it to the podium. And here's an interesting confrontation. Francesco Zerbi, who sent a letter a couple of weeks ago to Valentino Rossi, warning him of his conduct after that clash with Seta Gibinau in the final corner at Jerez. But it's Zerbi, the president of the FIM, who presents him with the winner's trophy 3 weeks later here in China. And the chairman of the sponsors for today, Taobao.com, Ma Yun, will present the team's trophy to Davide Brivio, and they extend their lead over Movistar Honda at the top of the championship to 17 points. It's a great day for Brivio, great day for Valentino Rossi, and a great day for Italy. Never quite gets tired of listening to that, does he, Valentino Rossi? His 70th Grand Prix victory in all classes, his 44th in the Premier class. And as I said, never gets tired of hearing that national anthem. I'm sure Marco Melandri would have enjoyed it as well. Marco Melandri, Olivier Jacques, and the winner of the first ever Chinese Grand Prix, Valentino Rossi, celebrate on the podium here. What a day it's been for all three riders. What a day it's been for all three classes. When the rain came this morning, we feared the worst, but we've been presented with a wonderful day of action here. Couldn't have asked for more in terms of entertainment. And this, the first ever race here for the MotoGP class at Shanghai, will be remembered for many, many years.